6 days of research methodology workshop. Today is day 7. In this regard, I would like to welcome our Dean, Professor P. F. Kutur, our Director of Research, Professor B. Vishnubhat, our Dean HPE, Professor V. N. Mahalakshmi, our Medical Superintendent, Professor K. Jay Singh, our respected guest speakers, Dr. N. Sri Kumaran Nair and Dr. M. Rajeshwari from JIPMER, all the respected participants for today's program. Before moving on to today's program, let's have a brief recap of yesterday's program. Now I request Dr. Balaji Chavan, first year PG in General Medicine, to present the repertoire report on yesterday's first lecture on inferential statistics. Dr. Balaji Chavan.
Can you hear me, sir? Good afternoon, sir.
Yes.
So, good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Balaji Chauhan, General Medicine, first year PG. I am here to summarize the yesterday's topic, which was discussed in research and methodology workshop, that was interstitial inferential statistics, which was taken by the Professor Sri Kumaran Nair, HOD of the Department of Biostatistics, JIPMER. Yesterday, in the first session, he discussed mainly 5 points, and in second session, he discussed 1 point. The 5 points which were discussed in the first session was basics of inference, estimates, standard error, confidence interval, and basics of testing of hypothesis. And the second session was of test of significance. So in short, within 5 minutes, we will see the five points which were discussed in brief. Statistical inference. What is statistical inference? It is a method of making inference about the research question. Estimation, summarizing the effect measures with uncertainty. Hypothesis testing, which is done by decision on whether to accept or reject the hypothesis. I'm just enumerating the points. The effect measures and uncertainty is done by summary, effect measures, standard errors, and confidence interval. So first 3 points, now we will see the fourth one, that is confidence interval. It is an interval estimate of the unknown population parameter. For example, prevalence in the population based on the random sample from the population. Confidence interval for population and estimation of confidence interval can be done by prevalence, incidence, odd ratio, relative risk, hazard ratio, correlation coefficient, regression coefficient. So summarizing and reporting of the outcome measure, which is done by summarize the continuous variable in terms of mean, standard error, and confidence interval. Continuous variable with a skewed distribution of data report in terms of geometric mean and geometric deviation. Third, summarize the ordinal variables as a median and interquartile range. Summarize the categorical variable as a frequency, frequency by relative risk, odd ratio, by this thing. And inference of the hypothesis. In last, we saw the inference of hypothesis by testing hypothesis and test of significance. The test of significance is basically of two types: parametric test of significance and non-parametric test of significance. In parametric test of significance, we saw the paired t-test, independent t-test, comparison of the two groups, more than two groups, analysis of variance. And at last, we saw the non-parametric test of significance. So these were the 5 points which were discussed in the first 1.5 hour session by Dr. Professor Sri Kumaran Nair about inferential statistics. Now, Dr. Reshma Nair, Reshma will present, will discuss in brief about the second session, which was of test of significance. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Now, thank you, Dr. Balaji Chavan. Now, I request Dr. Reshma Nair, PG in psychiatry, to present the report on second lecture on inferential statistics.
Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Reshma Nair, first year PG from Department of Psychiatry. I'll be talking about the recap of the second session taken yesterday by Dr. Harichandran Kumar KT from Department of Biostatistics in JIPMER University. He taught us about inferential statistics part two, about the various tests of significance that can be used. He created various case scenarios and told us about it. So mainly he told us about statistical inferences, which are inferences that are taken about, made about a population based on the results obtained from a sample drawn from that particular population. He told us about the various tests of significant statistical significances that can be used for making statistical inferences. So he told us about the importance of identification of right tools and methods that have to be taken based on how important research question, hypothesis, objectives are, the study design, the data type, the number of groups, the nature of groups or samples, the sampling and the sample size. So coming to the first, he told us about test of association, which mainly deals with categorical variables. So to find out any association between two independent proportions, he told us about chi-square test or Fisher's exact test, which mainly determines the test of association. In this test, both the variables should be categorical and it's not used for causal or any temporal relationship. The next he told us about McNamara's test, which mainly is used for comparison of two dependent proportions. So this test is mainly used for change in proportion over time, that is before and after two time points. Next comes the comparison of two independent groups for quantitative outcomes. So in this, mainly we have to test the normality initially. If it comes under normal distribution, we use the mean method with standard deviation. And if it comes under the if it's not normally distributed, we use the median method with the range method. So if it's comparative normally distributed quantitative outcome between two independent groups, we can use the independent students t-test, which is a parametric test which is used to compare two independent means. And if it's non-normally distributed outcome between two independent groups, we can use the Mann-Whitney u-test, which is a non-parametric test. Now for the comparison of two dependent groups for quantitative outcomes, depending on the same normal distribution or non-normally distribution, if it's normally distributed outcomes between two dependent groups, we can use the paired t-test, which is a parametric test. And with the comparison of two non-normally distributed outcomes between two dependent groups, we can use the Wilcoxon signed rank sum test, which is a non-parametric test. Now next comes the comparison of more than two independent groups for quantitative outcomes. Again, if it's normally distributed, we will be using the one-way analysis of ANOVA if it's normally distributed, that is an extension of independent student t-test. And if it's not normally distributed, we will be using the Kruskal-Wallis test, which is a non-parametric test, which is also an extension of Mann-Whitney u-test. Now for doing comparison of more than two dependent or related groups, we need to assess it at more than two different time points, that is we assess the change over time. If it's normally distributed, that is comparison of normally distributed outcome between more than two time points, we use repeated measures of ANOVA, that is the RM ANOVA, which is an extension of paired t-test. And if it's not normally distributed, using the median width range, we'll use the non-parametric repeated measures of ANOVA, that is also known as a Friedman's test, which is an extension of Wilcoxon signed rank sum test. Now for assessing the longitudinal changes happening within group, whether they are same or not, we use the two-way repeated measures of ANOVA, that is the two-way RM ANOVA, where two factors are mainly, which is based mainly on two factors. Now to assess the relationship between two quantitative variables, the correlation between them, if it comes under normal distribution, we use the Karl-Pearson's correlation test. And if it comes under the non-normal distribution curve, we use the Spearman's rank correlation, which is a non-parametric correlation test. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Reshma. So both Dr. Balaji and Dr. Reshma have well presented the report of yesterday's program. Now let's move on to our today's program. Today we have two lectures. One is on sample size, the other is on correlation and regression. Dr. M. Sri Kumaran Nair, Professor and Head, Department of Biostatistics, JIPMER, is going to deliver his lecture on sample size, concept and determination in health research. Now I call upon Dr. M. Sri Kumar Nair for the lecture. Sir, the stage is yours, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much again for the invitation. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, what about slides?
No problem, sir. Nicely seen.
Okay. Thank you, madam. Thank you. Okay, so next 1 hour, 15 minutes supposed to be, and what I do is a little bit of a description. I give about one of the main issue in medical research, that is the sample size. Okay, that is one of the usually people feel it as very, very crucial issue in medical research, but we feel it is not that crucial issue. But however, usually there is a tendency that sample size is done, everything is done in medical research. Okay. So what my overall theme of today's talk is give basic concept of this sample size determination. Okay. So a little bit explanation I give. Then if we get time, one or two examples, it's to be work it out. And this is a workshop, so I think it's the participants also we expect to do some work. Okay. So I will try to make you to do some work, in the sense it's a, you be ready with your mobile calculator. Okay. So it is good to, especially afternoon, after lunch, it's good to have a, and in online, it is good to have a computation in between. So that definitely interrupt your sleep. Okay. So, and it's any question, it is there, and you can put it in chat box, and it's we can answer. It's as well as it's the some of the problems what we are giving also, that's you, we expect you to compute and put it in the chat box, and we will see that. So that is what overall the description of this present session. So sample size, or it is basically how many subject we should recruit in any study. It should be a, it could be a cross-sectional study, it should could be a case control or cohort, or it's a clinical trial or whatever study it is. And what would be the number we have to start with? Okay. There are different people have different approaches. Some people tell, even I remember yesterday somebody said more than 30 is large. Okay, so some people tell, okay, you start with more than 30, then it's okay, everything it's been done. Some people tell, okay, if every group has got a 6, that's all right, then it is done. I don't know from what logic these things are coming, but however, scientifically, if you wanted to do a study and scientifically you wanted to establish, there are some basic concepts involved in it, and accordingly you have to determine the number of subjects. That is what we call it as sample size. Okay, you have to determine. There are some fundamental principles through which we approach the sample size, and out of that, the first one is you have to have your research question ready before you start the sample size. Okay. And second is the outcome measure. Yes, that it should be clear and ready before the sample size computation comes. Okay. You have to be very clear about the outcome measure. When I tell outcome measure, that variable, what type of variable it is there, is it a binary variable, it is a continuous variable, it is a categorical variable, all those things should be very clear about that. Okay. Then third point is, what are the statistical procedure involved in it? That means so far what we talked yesterday and day for yesterday and all these things, days we what been talked to you, everything is required to proceed for a sample size computation. So definitely I will take a little more time, a few more slides there to explain these concepts. But overall, what I am telling is you have to be very clear with the question, you have to be very clear with the outcome measure, and you have to be very clear with the statistical procedure in terms of even analysis, what type of analysis you are likely to do to calculate the sample size. That is the first thing. And then there are some assumptions, statistical and methodological assumptions in terms of study designs and the alpha, beta, all those things. I will come to the details of that again. So that is the second point. And the third one is, yes, you have a clarity on your study. The primary question is an estimation question, or it is a testing of hypothesis. You have to be very clear about it. The primary, you may do inside some testing of hypothesis, but your primary question you are going to answer with an estimation issue or it's a testing of hypothesis, that has to be very clear. And then the fourth one is constraints. Okay, so I put this fourth one as constraints. It's usually when even people come for sample size calculation, they are really worried about the study constraints and they put it first as the study constraints. I don't think that is the right approach. First, if you put it as a study constraints, then there is a problem. First, other three, you address it and then see what is a constraint and accordingly what can be done. So next couple of slides, these four points, I try to expand it, okay? Now, the first point, research question, outcome measure, and statistical procedure, okay? Just look at that. The research question. The question is dietary intervention effective in reducing blood pressure, okay? So it is a straight question. And when you ask such a question, for example, when you come for a sample size computation to me, I ask, what is your research question? And you tell, okay, dietary intervention, dietary changes, you are an intervention package you are implementing, and you wanted to study it is effective in reducing blood pressure, okay? So blood pressure is the outcome, and basically both outcome it could be, it's a systolic and diastolic blood pressure. And the reduction in blood pressure, that is you are looking at it, dietary intervention is effective in reducing blood pressure. So once you ask this question like this to me, I am very clear about your design. You are indirectly telling me, oh, it's going to be an RCT. It is a randomized controlled trial. You are telling me blood pressure, systolic and diastolic blood pressure, these are the two parameters, two variables you are measuring. And probably I consider it as a continuous variable. I can ask you that one. And then the reduction in blood pressure, it's probably you have an intervention group, you have a control group, and intervention group, how much is the reduction, control group, how much in reduction. And the difference between these two reduction, that is what I have to test. That means difference between two means probably a student t-test, okay? So what I am telling is the moment you ask the question, dietary intervention effective in reducing blood pressure, the appropriate question is, right away question is asked, outcome measure is clearly defined, and a statistical procedure based on yesterday, Dr. Hari's talked, difference in mean comparison, it is the, I mean, it's a t-test. It's everything is very evident that, okay? So your issue is comparing two means, and for that, how to calculate sample size, okay? For me, that is the message you give. It is a issue of comparing two means and an RCT and how to calculate sample size. So it's very clear. Suppose you look at the next question. Next question I am asking is incidence of MI different among diabetic and non-diabetic? Okay, so there is a diabetic group, there is a non-diabetic group. Again, two groups are there. And measurement is incidence of MI. So incidence, it is a proportion, okay? So incidence, it's a proportion, and you are measuring incidence, probably it would be a cohort study. There are two cohorts, diabetic cohort and non-diabetic cohort, and incidence you are measuring, and incidence difference or not. So incidence is a proportion, isn't it? And then, so your outcome variable is a binary variable, MI yes or no, and finally converted that as an effective measure, incidence, okay? It is a proportion. And two proportion in the diabetic group proportion you measure, non-diabetic proportion you measure, and then the statistical analysis is comparison of two proportion. Probably it is a chi-square test, or you usually people do an Z test, comparison of two proportions, okay? So you can do a chi-square test. So what I am telling is, the moment you tell your question very clearly, your outcome measure is very clear, your effective measure is very clear, and your statistical procedure is very clear. But what we usually experience is people are not clear about their research question. They don't tell research question in terms of that what population, what intervention or exposure you are looking at it, and what is a comparison and outcome. All those things you don't specify it, or you are not trained, or you are not competent enough to do that. And then there is a problem. Okay, now move to the next one. Suppose somebody is interested, it's as a cross-sectional study, the prevalence of MI among hypertensive. Okay, among hypertensive, probably it is a hospital-based study. You are not going even in the community. The people who are attending in a medicine OPD, how many are hypertensive? Among hypertensive, people who are with hypertension, out of that, how many are the developed MI? Okay, it could be even a community-based study, no issue. Okay, so but the question is prevalence of MI, that is what you are looking at. And once you state this as your research question, immediately I get, okay, the keyword, it is a prevalence estimation. Okay, it is no more a comparison, it is a prevalence estimation. Okay, so prevalence is nothing but it is statistically expressed as a proportion, and it is a proportion estimation. That is my issue. And immediately I can identify which would be the way to do a sample size computation. And now you look at it. The fourth question there, what is the average cholesterol level of patient admitted with EMI? What is the average cholesterol level of patient admitted with EMI? So the population is people with EMI, that is the population. And the outcome variable is cholesterol. Okay, outcome variable is cholesterol value. So total cholesterol, suppose you take it as total cholesterol, that is what we are looking at it, okay? So it is a continuous variable. So outcome variable is a continuous variable. Population is people admitted with MI, and it is more a cross-sectional study, and the effective measure is average or arithmetic mean. So it is a continuous variable. Effective measure is arithmetic mean, and it is estimation of mean, okay? So if you look at it, based on your research question, your outcome variable, the statistical procedure, everything it's decided. And this is very, very important to proceed for the sample size calculation. And next couple of minutes, or next maybe 20, 25 minutes, how these things having an effect on sample size determination, that is what I would like to talk. Okay, so this is the first part of one of it, is a research question, outcome measure, and a statistical procedure. How should get streamlined before you move to sample size computation. So this is a one point. Now we move to the next point. What are the statistical and methodological assumptions? Okay, these things yesterday we talked a lot. Look at it. Yes, alpha. Now I don't have to tell what is alpha. It is a probability of type 1 error. And that probability, if you wanted to control as less, yesterday we said, yes, you can use it 0.05, you can use it 0.01, or you can use it 0.001. Okay, that means you wanted to bring down that probability of that type of type 1 error as minimum as possible. But nothing come free. If you wanted really, really control that type 1 error to 0.001, you have to pay more. That is more subjects you have to recruit. Otherwise, you are a little liberal. You can afford up to 0.05. That means 5% type of probability of type 1 error. Then probably you have to do less sample size. Okay, so sample size has got a direct impact. Alpha type 1 error has got a direct impact on the sample size. Okay, we will see after two or three slides, we will see some real example where this alpha is making a change in the sample size. Now, beta, what is beta? Yes, type 2 error. Beta you wanted to reduce, that means you wanted to have more power. In fact, I remember yesterday, it's Dr. Batsar asked, it's a power 80% or 90%. Okay. So, and that, then I said, if 80%, usually 80%, we can take it so that a moderate sample size. Suppose you wanted to be so precise, you wanted to increase your power as it's 90%. That means beta further less, beta 10%. Okay. That means it will increase your sample size. And somebody is too stringent, wanted to even further bring it down beta to 5%. That means 95% power, probably you get a very, very huge sample size. So beta is also having a direct role in the determination of sample size. Then, so the more power, more subject you require it. That is, this is the reason sometimes it's a sample size less and you publish the results, the journal editorial board also ask you to please calculate what is the power and send that document also. The reason is the sample size really bringing it down the power or not, they wanted to see that. Then another aspect is the sample size required for a one-sided. There are something called one-sided and two-sided test. It means how do you set the null and alternate hypothesis? For example, it is reduced or not reduced, or equal or not equal. I'm not talking too much about that hypothesis. That may be another advanced course we can talk, but there are something called a one-sided test and a two-sided testing of hypothesis. Next example, you will find that relation there, but that is a statistical procedure. According to that, again, sample size change. If it is a one-sided test, sample size is less, and two-sided test, sample size is more. Okay, you require it, okay? So whatever that one-sided, two-sided example, when we talk more about it. So what I'm telling is, yes, there is a second statement, statistical and methodological assumption make a point. And then continuation of that statistical and methodological assumption. Yesterday, Hari talked about various type of test of significance. Yes, it's a t-test, paired, and t-test unpaired. Unpaired t-test, there is another one way of calculating sample size. T-test, paired t-test, another way of calculating sample size. ANOVA, one way of calculating sample size. Repeated measures ANOVA, another way. Chi-square, another way. That means, depending on your statistical procedure, it's a sample size computation formula will change. Okay, it is not one magic formula for all sample size computation. Okay, so that is the second point. Then third point is, okay, so these two things, it's I said. Then third point, I divided into two things. One is, as I said, it's either it could be a hypothesis testing or it could be a estimation problem. So I thought first I'll talk about, even though order is estimation first and hypothesis testing second, but I thought I talk first hypothesis testing and then estimation. The reason is, I don't know, by 3:15 everything will be over. Even if it is not over, I'm sure hypothesis testing issue will be covered during that time. Okay, but I'm guaranteeing it's probably, I will try to finish everything, it's by 3:15. But that is why I'm moving first, as it's a problem of hypothesis testing. So you have the research question in place, outcome measure in place, statistical procedure in place, alpha, beta, all those things in place. Okay. And with that preamble, we move to the first issue of how we calculate sample size for hypothesis testing. Okay. Now, when it comes to hypothesis testing, another crucial question, if you approach a statistician, another crucial question they ask is, because it's in the hypothesis testing, it is basically, you have seen there are two scenarios. One is difference in proportion, another is difference in mean. Okay, there are many situations like that, but two such situations we are taking. And when you approach a statistician for a sample size calculation, usually there will be a question, how much difference is clinically important and how the clinically significant? Okay. How much difference between, they ask one additional question, how much difference between two group is clinically important and clinically significant? Okay. And for example, suppose between two groups where the systolic blood pressure difference, when you look at it, a large difference only clinically you feel it as important. Please be very careful about my statement. It is not coming from previous studies or something. You as an expert in general medicine, expert in internal medicine, you feel that, okay, in systolic blood pressure, if 5 unit reduction, then I'm concerned about it. If my study give 5 unit reduction, then I am interested in this intervention, providing this intervention to the people. Okay, so this 5 unit telling, it is not an easy job. You have to have your expertise in place. You have to have your team in place. It's a huge debate will give you this number. And when you see the numerical example, you will understand more about it. Now you read it as the clinical significant, how much difference is clinically important, okay? And your statement, if it's a large difference between groups only clinically important, probably you need a small sample size, okay? And if very small difference is clinically important, you want it, it is sometimes people call it as a detectable difference. Okay. Sometime in the literature, you will find the minimum detectable difference. That is another terminology people used. Minimum detectable difference or clinically important difference. Okay. Or clinically, sometimes people call it a significant difference. That means clinically, it is nothing to do with the statistical significant, clinical significant. This much difference it happens between these two groups in terms of this outcome measure, this effect measure, then I consider this intervention is important one, okay? So it's a large difference only you wanted to detect as significant, then it's you need only a small sample size and a small difference if you wanted to, even a very small difference you wanted to detect it, then you need a large sample size. Probably 2 examples when we look at it, you get more clarity on this point. Okay, so keep this, even if you are not a little confused about this, okay, when you read the question, you get it. So what I said is, when hypothesis test it is coming, alpha you have to know very well, beta what limit you wanted to keep, you should know well, and what is your outcome measure, you should know clear, what statistical procedure you know clear, and what difference clinically important you should know. With all those things, if you frame your sample size question, then I think either a statistical package will give or a statistician will able to give answer. Okay. Now with this preamble of 3-4 slides, I now introduce a problem to you. Just to take a minute, read this question. I request everybody to read it. And you should be able to frame your question, sample size question like this. If you are able to frame, then yes, you are the master of your research, and either statistical package or statistician will be able to give the sample size. The question is, an intervention trial was planned to study the effect of structured physical activity on diabetic control. Okay. That is all right. So it is an intervention trial and it is planning the effect of structured physical activity on diabetic control. Normal experience is that even with a routine exercise, 20% of adults have control in their glucose level. Okay, this statement you find it's very easily it is made, but it is not very easy. Probably it is based on your experience and previous studies, all those things. And outcome variable, now it is very clear there, glucose level is the outcome variable. And even if not doing any structured exercise, 20% means routine care, 20% of the people are able to control their glucose values. Okay. Now look at the next statement. The investigator feel that the structured program can be considered as effective. That is very, very important. The investigator feels that the structured program can be considered as effective if it can convert at least 50% of the diabetes to control their glucose values during 6 months of intervention. That is, intervention is 6 months, and that period, if this 20% can move to 50%, because 20% even otherwise it happens, okay? 20% anyway, it is baseline, the benefit is there. If the intervention group can move to 50%, that means if there is a 30% increase, I consider that is what clinically important difference. Okay, that is what clinically significant difference. A 30, as an investigator or an investigating team, I am telling, I can 30% increase happens. That means this 20% move to 50%, then only I'd want to tell this study, this intervention program is effective. It is not then only I will do the trial. Trial anyway, you have to do it. But 30% more people get benefited, get improved their, control their glucose values, then I definitely prescribe this program to the next patient. So that is what, that is the authority I am telling you about it, okay? And such a, in such a scene, so this is the way you have to ask the question. It takes some time to frame the question. In fact, a sample size calculation, the most important is point is the framing the question for sample size. That is a place statistician and investigator have a fight each other. Investigator then after that don't look at the statistician, and the statistician don't talk to the investigator. So the simple reason is we are not able to frame the question properly. Frame the sample size question properly. And this question originate from the study design, originate from the study question, and was originate from the study outcome variable. Okay, so once you frame that question, additional point, we would like to have a minimum power of 80%. That means I don't want to come below 80% power. 80% it is okay, acceptable. And so final comparison, statistical comparison will be done at 5% level of significance. That means alpha I wanted at 5%. And beta, 1 minus beta is 80%. Power is 80%, alpha is 5%. So I am very clear about what I wanted. Then I'm sure, okay, there will be some loss to follow up because this is an intervention trial, and 10% is I am anticipating loss to follow up. And for that, what would be the sample size? Okay. Now, what this is the framework you should be, whoever is listening to it, it's, you should try to make it. It is not the first day itself you will be able to write like this. Maybe you have to write 10 drafts again and again this, to make finally get into this paragraph. And once you have this paragraph, I think it's almost your study design, outcome measure, analysis plan, as well as the crucial question for sample size, everything is very clear. And somebody can give the formula for sample size and can, I mean, even there are power and sample size calculation. There are various packages available. You can calculate sample size. I mean, however, today manually we will try to do that. Okay. Now look at it. There is a slide, there is a formula for sample size. This is here the it is a proportion. You realize it is a proportion. The outcome, the effect measure is proportion. So sample size calculation, how it is, there is a formula, n is equal to something it is there, PEQ and all those things are there. Don't worry about those things, okay? But still, you will try to understand this thing. Okay, you come down the last, there N is equal to, there is a formula, okay? In that left side is N, that is what your sample size, that is the size of each group. And here one more assumption is equal number in each group, control group and intervention group have equal number, that is 1:1 ratio, that is what your recruitment, that is what. So little bit I talk about that formula, even though I said you don't have to bother about that equation right side what it is written, but little bit try to understand it. Okay, left side it is nothing but sample size N, and what is right side? Right side is a very complex, it looks like a complicated expression, but in a simple way you look at it. Right side, what you find is it has got a numerator, which is a complicated one, and a denominator, it is another the complicated one. Okay, so but you can look at it, it is a numerator and denominator, that's all you have to look at it. It is something like A by B. Okay, A is the numerator and B is the denominator. Just look at it, that denominator, what it is. It is something called a P1 minus P2. And what is P1? Proportion in the intervention group, in the control group, and P2 is the proportion in the intervention group. So P1 minus P2 is what would be the anticipated clinically important proportion. The difference between two groups, what you consider it as clinically important. That is what you stated. In your problem, it is 30%. So the denominator P1 minus P2 is, it's the proportion, the difference between two group, you clinically important or detectable difference. 20% versus 30%. That means, 20% versus 50%. That means 50 minus 20 is equal to 30%. You only stated that. As an investigator, you stated the in case 30% increase in the effect in the intervention group, I consider it as clinically important. That the point is that 30% is coming in the denominator. Okay, that 30% is coming in the denominator, and you understand the simple arithmetic A by B, B is the denominator. Now 30% it is coming in the denominator, and you get a sample size. And another person decided, no, even 20%
difference.
Hello. I don't know, some noise is coming. Anybody can respond? Any additional noise? No, I think it's all right now, I think. Okay. Okay, so what is that? That is a denominator, it is coming, and the denominator reduces, the sample size increases. So denominator 30%, you bring it down to 20%, your sample size increases. That 20%, you bring it down to 10%, sample size increases, so that is the way sample size moves up, okay? And then you look at it, alpha and beta, they are in the numerator, Z alpha and Z beta. Z alpha, exactly yesterday, Hari spoke about it, it's a normal deviate, its values. And as alpha comes down, Z alpha increases, and that is appearing unfortunately in the numerator, so sample size goes up. And Z beta, yes, power beta decreases, power increases, and then it's a Z beta, it goes up, it is again coming in the numerator. So I know that it's an algebraic expression I am showing, don't worry about it, but a simple message I am telling is, you fixed the alpha, you fixed the beta, you fixed the clinically important difference, okay? And these are the three things, decide your sample size. Alpha less, your sample size increases, beta less, your sample size increases, and clinically important difference, detectable difference decreases, your sample size increases. Okay, and that is the way sample size been calculated. So with this again description, we move to solve that the problem, the previous problem. What is it? In the previous problem, P1 is equal to 0.2, and don't worry about this calculation. Q1 is 1 minus P1, that is 0.8. P2 is 0.5, so Q2 is on the 1 minus 0.5 is 0.5. Then there is a way of calculating P and Q, that's 0.2 and 0.5. Ideally, you don't have to do all these computation now, packages are available. But why I'm demonstrating with an example is, you have to realize that the input what you are giving, it is making a decision about the sample size. It is not the input a statistician is giving. As an investigator, you are providing alpha, you are providing beta, you are providing clinically detectable difference. And those are the things it's making a role in the sample size. And it's this, that is why alpha is 5%. It's a Z beta, Z alpha is 1.96. Beta is, it's a 20%. That means it's 80% power. It's a Z beta is 0.84. Now, once you have these things, you substitute in this equation and you have your N. Each group, it's a 39. That is the 39 subjects you require in each group. And so total number of subjects required the trial is 78. And dropout, okay, 10%. That is a place also sometimes people make a mistake. Okay. It is not 10% of 7.78 you have to add. That is usually it is done like that. 10% of 78 you got total, so 10% of 7.78, that is probably 7.8, you add it to the sample size, you get the final sample size. That is not correct, okay? It is to get 90, you have to recruit 100, then to get 78, how many? Just like a primary school, we teach divisions and multiplication. To get 90, because at the end, to get 90, see 10% dropout. That means if you recruit 100, you get 90. That means to get 90, you have to recruit 100. Then at the end, to get 78, how many should be recruited? That is the way 86 it's come. It's just a way, it's a, you know, 100 by 90 you have to multiply. So this is the way sample size computation is done. Okay. Now, just 2 minutes, 2 to 3 minutes, I need you to do some exercise. Okay. So even in this problem, I made a change in the, just read it. What is a change? The problem is same, only change is, can somebody tell what is a change? Anybody has the courage to respond? What is the change?
Now for 50%, it is 40%.
50%. Good, good, good. Very good. 50% is reduced to 40%. That means this investigator tell, no. Even I don't want to wait 30% difference. Even 20% difference happens, then I feel this intervention program. After all, you don't have to pay anything. It is a structured physical activity. Otherwise also it is a healthy. So even 20% people additional benefit, 20% people additionally get benefited. I am okay with that. Okay. Even that means a small, little smaller difference you want to pick it up. Okay. And then what will happen? That's all. Everything else, 20% continue to be there. But 50% brought down to 40% and 80% power and 5% level of significance, everything is same. So look at it. So P1 0.2 continue to be that, but P2 become 0.4 and Q2 0.6. And what is it? P is 0.3 and Q is 0.7, Z alpha 1.76, and he said beta 0.84. That much calculation I have done. Okay, now it is your turn. Do the calculation. Even I put the numbers in place. Please calculate. I haven't calculated. And the chat box, you put the sample size. Just because since it's a workshop, you have to do some work. Anybody got the sample size? I wanted somebody to, people to prove mathematics is wrong. In the sense of the same formula, different people may get different numbers, different sample size. So far, I haven't seen anything in the chat box. Anything? No number. Somebody got it. It's 18. Anything further? Okay. I don't see any more number. I don't know. Okay, so the basic thing is, it's usually what I expect is the denominator has come down and this n should be, and n usually it move up. Okay, this is what the denominator, earlier it was 0.3 and this has come down to 0.2, and the study design is same, everything else is outcome is same, everything else is same, but you set this clinical significance is 0.2, earlier you set it as 0.3, and that give a different sample size, that is one. Similar to that, is that beta, suppose you, is that alpha, if you change it to 0.01, this value may go up to 2.58 or something. And that will again, so numerator is more, means sample size goes up. And beta, suppose you, if you will make it as 90%, this again move to 1.32 or something, that again, and then there is a square for that, that again increase the sample size. That means level of significance comes here, it increases the sample size, and power comes here, that if with the high power, then this also goes up, it increases the sample size. A small clinically important difference, that is it's coming in the denominator, and that also, that is increases the sample size. That is what I meant, sample size, okay? Then total number of subjects required, you can calculate, it's based on the what is the loss to follow up, okay? So dropout rate and all those things, it's, you can calculate. Okay, we cannot spend too much time on this because I have a few couple of other things to finish. So that's a, now the one example, we took a lot of time, but the remaining examples, I don't want to take that amount of time. So the only, what I am telling is, lot of input you provide, or as an investigator, we have to provide to get into a sample size calculation, and scientifically it has been calculated based on all those statistical principles or probability principles. Okay, so here the thing is, it's again an RCT, and outcome variable is, it's a dietary approach they are looking at it, it's a, and a blood pressure, that is what they're looking at it, it's systolic BP, but here the variable is a continuous variable. And when the otherwise the design is same, it's an RCT, but the variable is a continuous variable and the power is 90% and level of significance kept it as 5%. So most of the things continue to be same. But if you look at here, the formula got changed. Here again, alpha has come the numerator, beta, these things are in the numerator, and the same logic will go, low level of significance, this will increase, sample size increases, high power, this will increase, sample size increases, and this is a clinically detectable difference, it is coming in the denominator, this is smaller and small, sample size increases, this is the standard deviation of the variable, that is earlier it was differently stated there, so it's a stand, as the standard deviation increases, that means your variable has got more variation, and then sample size goes up. Suppose your variable is, it's a very, very consistent variation, it's a within data variation is very limited, then this standard deviation will be very small and the sample size will be small. So that is the way you understand the formula. Otherwise, you don't have to by heart anything. But the star positions of this various thing decide the sample size, okay? So that is the way it is, this one, for example, data is 2.1, and I don't want to go much details about it, okay? Once you substitute this, you are getting a sample size, okay? 2 into 1.96 plus this one, and this, you are getting a sample size of 202, and total size is 404, okay? Now, in the same thing, suppose we change, something and see what will happen, okay? Here, this one, it's a five, the difference that a denominator of what a 2.1, I changed to same question, I changed to 5 millimeter mercury. That means at least on the average, 5 millimeter mercury change between group, then only you consider it as clinically important. And if that is so, everything else continue to be same. All these things continue to be same, except this one. This one, earlier it was 2.1, changed it to 5, and that denominator changed. That is the next exercise for you. Please, this is much simple one. you calculate and put it in the chat box. Anybody could get a number? Yes, I think it's there are a few numbers have come. Somebody got 35.52, somebody got 17.8, like that. It's okay, various numbers it's have come. So basically, actually, ideally, all should get the same number. That is what mathematics. Okay, mathematics, you cannot save the formula, because 4 by 2, it has to be 2. It cannot be, you know, somebody get a 2 and somebody get a 5. It cannot be like that. Okay. That anyway, you can calculate, you can do that. Now you realize the same problem 2.1 has changed to 5, and that decision you made it and you got a different sample size. Okay, so that is what you have to understand. So this one, if you change, you get a different sample size. This one you change, you get a different sample size. This one you change, you get a different sample size. And this, if you change, you get a different sample size. So that means the sample size is determined by, in fact, I wanted to tell it is not by the formula, basically input given by you. Okay, input given by you, substituted in the formula, and its sample size is obtained. Okay, so I don't talk much time for it. It's now you got the issue with the comparison, how it is. Okay. So there are various other situations, and that definitely you have to, because this is a preamble I'm telling, or just a concept I'm telling, because within 1.5 hours, or it's even 1 week, we cannot complete all sample size computation formula. Okay, now another 10-15 minutes I have, and during that time, what I would like to do is the estimation. Okay, in the third point, there was a testing of hypothesis issue I talked, and alpha, beta, clinically important difference, all these things play a role in the sample size computation. Okay, now when it comes to the estimation problem, the problem is slightly different. Here, it is basically a trade-off between precision of estimate and sample size. I remember yesterday I said it's today I will talk about precision. There was a question about precision yesterday, somebody asked. So this is a time we clarify that. When you talk about estimate, what level of precision you require? Okay, the first is my slide, abstract statement I am making, and second slide we will go for the computation exactly with a numeric. That's the time you understand better. Look at it here. If you need a very precise estimate, okay, you need a large sample size. I think it's nobody has to tell that. It is very clear. If you are a decision, you want it to be so precise, okay, estimate wanted to be so precise, then large sample size you require, and less precision. You are ready to you can afford. You can compromise some level of precision, then small sample size is okay. Okay. Then there are two concepts. It is called absolute precision and relative precision. When the example comes, I will talk about that. But at this point of time, you remember absolute precision probably require a small sample size. Relative precision require a large sample size. Okay. Who will specify the first column? Precision is specified again by the investigator. In fact, as a statistician, I am pushing everything to the investigator because you are the owner of your study, so you cannot run away. As a statistician, I can run away. But I am pushing to you, you have to specify, you need a high precision or you are ready to compromise a little bit with the precision. You need absolute precision or relative precision. Okay, so yeah, you have to specify that and accordingly sample size changes. Okay, now look at this question. A study aims to estimate the prevalence. It's a cross-sectional study. Prevalence estimation, type 2 diabetes among population 30 years and above. So how many subjects you should include in your survey? So that prevalence may be estimated within a precision of 2% points. That one we have to state it very clearly. With a precision of 2% points of the true value with a 95% confidence level. Actually, somebody yesterday asked the level of significance and this precision same or not. They are different. Okay. Here, you look at a 2% points of the true value with a 95% confidence level. First, I will try to make it a little more clear about this. What is this? When you tell 2% point precision, what it is telling is at the end, suppose you get a prevalence, your survey give a prevalence of 10%. What you are accepting is 2%, 2 point forward and 2 4 point backward. That means 10 plus or minus 2, 10 plus 2, 10 minus 2. That means 8 to 12, that band you are ready to accept it. So my estimate should be in that band with again 95% confidence level. Okay. 95% confidence level, my estimate should be in that band. Okay, so that is what you are telling. Okay, so confidence level is different from that precision you are talking there. Okay, so that is, and suppose you get a prevalence of this the diabetes as 7%, then 2% up and down, that means 5 to 9. Okay, what I can afford, yes, 5 to 9. Okay, 2 point left and 2 point right, 2 point upward and 2 point backward with a confidence level of 95%. That means there could be what you have to understand. 2%, 5% studies, there may be some study report even beyond this limit. But your study, it's within this limit, it has to come. Okay. Then one more of the crucial question somebody asked, what would be the anticipated true prevalence rate? Actually, you are trying to understand what is the prevalence, and it's a funny question is asked, what is the true prevalence, anticipated prevalence? But we have no choice, you have to get it. And so at least an upper limit one can tell, and that is why stated here exceed 8. Okay, and this formula, I think it's, you are very familiar with this formula, and unfortunately I'm sorry to tell, I find very often people think this is the only formula for sample size calculation. So even it's a RCT, even if it's a case control study, cohort study, everything people use this formula, which is absolutely wrong. This is a formula only for estimation of proportion, and that also when you specify absolute precision. Okay, you substitute these values and you get the sample size. Okay. Anyway, I have to rush through a few more examples. Now, look at here, the same question, I brought it back. But the precision is 2% is changed to 5%. And then you change your formula, D become 0.05, remaining everything is same. And sample size, probably you can calculate the sample size. Even I think it's a, this question can be, it's I think organizers can give this question for the test. I think Sarah has announced already, Madam has announced an award also for people. So they can, this can be one of the question, yes, for the, you know, post test. Okay, what is a sample size? Now, because I don't have more time to work with that question again, now look at this question. It is exactly same question, but I changed that precision 2% relative precision. Earlier it was absolute precision, now I changed it as relative precision. When I tell relative precision, the point is, whatever I get it, 2% of that left and right. So suppose at the end, 10% is the prevalence I get it, 2% of 10%. That is a very, very small number, okay? 2% of 10%. That is something like 0.02 or something. So it is very, very small. Okay. And once you have, so you have to be very, very careful. You are specifying relative precision or absolute precision, because there is a danger with this. When you said that 2% relative precision, your formula got changed. And the denominator, if you look at not only D square, that P square also has come. And that changed your sample size as a huge, huge one. Okay. So just for fancy purpose, don't tell it is a relative precision I am interested in. Relative precision, if you take differently, your sample size will go up much more than that of the absolute precision. Okay. So that is why large scale surveys, usually people take relative precision, and other way, small studies, small surveys, it's usually people take absolute precision. That is what, okay? So you wanted to take a relative precision or absolute precision, really you have to have a conversation with your team as well as your the statisticians also, so that they can explain to you very well, okay? So what I am telling is, the relative precision or absolute precision, it make a difference, and it change the formula and its calculation, it will change. Okay. Now, similar to that, estimation of mean, I think it's, I spoke a lot, similar to that estimation of mean also. Okay. The earlier we talked about estimation of proportion. Now we are talking about estimation of mean. Now I don't have to spend much time. Okay. Again, there is a formula. And you look at it, that the precision as well as the standard deviation come in the formula, and you get the number. Okay. And suppose you change the standard deviation, and see, just look at the formula. Somebody can note down the formula, because I have a final exercise for you. Z alpha into sigma is the standard deviation, and D is the precision. That is what it said, 1 unit error margin. Okay, hemoglobin, BMI, when you estimate 1 unit error margin left and right, you are telling about whatever you get it. So that is, this is the error margin, this is the standard deviation, and this is the at alpha level normal deviate. Okay, and this is the formula. Please note down this formula. And then in this problem, 1.96, you know what it is. and one is the error margin is set, and four is the standard deviation is set, and so this multiplication and this square will give 61. Okay, now exercise for you is standard deviation. This four I brought it down to two, anticipated standard deviation. Many times you get it from previous studies regarding that particular variable. Standard deviation you can get, and it's reduced to two. And what is the sample size? You substitute it and you get it? In the place of four, you have to substitute two and you have to calculate. And let me get what it is. Take 1 minute, please calculate. It is a workshop, so participants should do some work. Anyone got it? Some number. This 4 will be changed to 2. Actually, it should not take too much time. I don't know. Everybody is attending or... Okay, we will see the chat box later. See, this is a 16, that is what you got. It's a, there is an easy way you could have done it. It's okay, it can do that. Okay. So that is what the estimation. So then come to the last point and probably my last slide. So we talked about the all other 3 points, the research question, outcome measures, statistical procedure, alpha, beta, and the all assumptions. And then for the estimation, how to go ahead with the sample size and the testing of hypothesis to go ahead the sample size. And finally, yes, you have to look at the finance, material, manpower, logistic support, all those things. You know, yeah, don't stop the sample size calculation at the beginning itself by telling that I don't have the finance, I don't have the material, because you don't know what is a number. And without calculating the number, how you are telling I don't have the material. So please then come down to the at the end only this issue. And then another thing, that ethical issue I wanted to tell is, if you are doing a study without having an adequate number, based on your parameters, that itself is unethical, because it's at the end of the study you give a recommendation saying that the sample size was not enough, so do another study. Then why you have done the study? Okay, so that is a point, and that is a place I stop. Okay, that is all from my side, and thank you very much, Dr. Batsar. It's a pleasure always. To work with you. I mean, when I joined the first day, I think it's probably I met you at Jipmer, and it's always a pleasant experience to work with you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
We are also very thankful to you, because whenever we request you, like, that is equally important.
Yeah, when you request, I cannot tell no, sir. Yes, it's that is yes.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your elaborate lecture on sample size calculation. Any questions from the audience?
One thing I wanted to clarify, yesterday somebody was asking Dr. Hari about the central limit theorem and a sample size 30. One thing is, in fact, I felt that question is not appropriate. One is, the central limit theorem never talk about a number 30. Okay, central limit theorem is one of the fundamental theorem in statistics. That never talk about the number 30. It talk about sampling distribution, then as sample size increases, this estimate minus its expectation, and there is a statistics it follows, and it follows normal distribution. It is not talking about the data. Somebody yesterday was telling about the data, after 30 it will follow normal distribution. It is not about the data. It is about the sampling distribution. Sampling distribution, as n tends to infinity, it moves to standard normal distribution. It is not talking about the data. So,
sir, there is a question from Dr. Arthi.
Yeah.
When is a post-hoc power analysis necessary?
Yeah, post-hoc power analysis necessary. Suppose you fixed a power and you did the study, for especially it is asked for clinical trials, you did the study, and some more, for example, this COVID situation, you cannot achieve the final sample size. So usually in that situation, people ask, please do a power analysis and see that it's because you could not complete the sample size, how much the reduction happens in power. So that has to be, that means it is a reduced number, you got it, but that really reduced the power of the study or not. Can we believe in your results? Can we interpret your results? That is why. So that is one of the issue, one of the time it's usually asked for a power analysis.
Thank you, sir. Shall we move on to the next?
Yeah, thank you very much. Yes, I stop sharing.